testimony. And I was stuck on one thing, and then I texted John on Monday night, and I said, hey, man, I think God wants me to talk about fear. And really how it relates to my life, or how it has related to my life, but really the fear of failure. You know, like, God has not given us a spirit of fear, right? But a spirit of love and a sound mind and of power. And so when I think about that, I'm like, all right, God, well, here I am getting an opportunity to speak in front of many people here. I would honestly rather I could sing in front of you for days. You're getting to speak in front of you. It's a different story. It really is. But, you know, I feel that the fear of failure or fear of whatever is probably a big cause in many of our lives at some point in time, or maybe there still is. You know, a fear of failure maybe as a student of, I might not make the grades, I might not get there, and what if I don't get there? You know, my parents think I should be here, and I'm not. What am I going to do? Okay? Or maybe the fear of failure is, now you're kind of grown up, right? Now, maybe you have a family of your own, maybe not a family of your own yet, but your career starts. And where is that fear of failure? You want to succeed. You want to keep going and keep going and keep going. But when that failure comes, what do you do? You know, do you sit back and stay down and say, I'm done, I can't do it? Or maybe a fear of failure as a husband or as a wife, as a dad or a mom. You know, it can creep in so many different ways. I love how Paul states it in Romans. Probably one of my favorite verses at this point in time in my life over the last few months is in Romans 12:2. He says, we are not to be conformed to this world or the patterns of this world, but we are to be transformed by the renewing of our minds. So we're not to be conformed to the world. Well, there's a lot of fear. There's things everywhere that says, hey, you can't do this, you can't do that. Well, that's not for us to be concerned about. If we're believers in Christ, we know, Lord, allow me to have the renewing of that mind. Allow me to have that transformation. That's what we want. That's what he's here for. So that we can be good and pleasing and have goodwill. So the first point I want to make is, well, it has to be on first. Hey, I think it's on, but it's not going. Okay. All right. First point I want to make is, we can choose to allow failure to define us or refine us. Define us or refine us. So what do we mean by that? You know, when I was back in college, I was a senior out there. It was 17 years ago. There's probably some of you in this crowd that aren't even 17 years ago. And I'm saying it was 17 years ago. That was my senior year of college. Okay? That's crazy to me. But senior year of college, I played baseball through school, had a great opportunity to do that. We had a couple weekends left of the season. And I told the middle school group this as well, because I asked them, I said, hey, what's your biggest fear? And I told them, I said, man, when it comes to athletics, I feel like I can go on a basketball court and beat everybody until I start getting beat. But I'll still be there. Okay? So my senior year, we're on our way. We had a great season. Right there at the top of the conference. Really only needed to win a couple games, three games, to lock everything up, to be conference champs. And we're away at this field. Won the first game. We're down by a run. Top of the seventh, we were the visiting team. And one guy was on, and it was me up to bat. And I said, man, I'm just waiting for my pitch, okay? It's going to be my pitch, And I've always, any time in my career, I may have tried to hit a home run, but I never hit the home run when I tried to hit the home run. But at that point in time, I said, there's nothing to lose. I'm going to do this. Got the pitch, hit it over the fence. We scored a couple more runs. We won the game. I remember getting into the bus, listening to my coach say, talking to the assistant, saying, man, I think that saved our season right there. You know, what Ken did, it saved our season. And I was thinking about that. I was like, man, that's awesome. I love hearing the coach say that. Well, then the following weekend came, and it was actually really rainy like it is right now. And we actually, it wasn't King University at that time. It was King College. And went up to King College. They were having a tough season. And I said, all right, all we got to do is win one game. That's it. One game, and we're good. And we lost the first game. Second game comes. Top of the seventh. It's my turn again. Have some guys on. We're losing by a run. I said, man, all I got to do is get a base hit. We'll win this game. We'll take the conference. Those of you that don't know, you get four balls and three strikes, one way or the other. You walk or you strike out. And I remember the count was 2-2, and all of a sudden, fear came creeping in. Like, all of a sudden, something came in, and I said, it was like, you can't do this. Like, you just did it before. It's not your time, whatever. And I watched the pitch go right down the middle, strike three, game over. I was paralyzed by fear of that moment. Some people might say, hey, you choked. Well, I guess that could be the term you could say. Yeah, I did. But strike three, it's done. I'm done. I'm walking to the dugout. You know, not to say that was the only reason that we lost the game or that we didn't win the conference, but we came in second place at that conference. And I can remember that, and it brings me to understand, you know, that's what fear does. Fear paralyzes you, right? Fear paralyzes you. Faith mobilizes you, okay? So God doesn't give me a spirit of fear, right? He wants me to overcome whatever that is. So in Romans, if I can get there, next slide. Romans 5, 3-5, it says, not only so, but are also glory in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance, character, character, hope, and hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. I love that verse. I love that verse. It tells us exactly what we need to know. How many times does the enemy try to put shame on you for failing at something? Whatever that is. Maybe it's school. Maybe it's through your career. That's what the enemy tries to bring upon you. But right there in that verse where Paul writes, it's not to come upon us. Okay, we're supposed to persevere through these times. I can tell you that I've done a lot of persevering through my life in different situations. I've allowed fear to take over me in some areas to where that fear of failure conquered me. All right, before I was with my current employer, I was with the competitor. And I had a lot of things going great. I was on the rise. I was 24, 25 years old. A lot of great things were happening in my life, financially and in other areas. But I didn't want to fail. Did not want to fail. And then all of a sudden, things got rough on me. Something happened, sometimes not even under my control, but all of a sudden I started to feel the pressure of being successful. And through that, I failed with this employer. I made some decisions that I shouldn't have made that allowed me to come into an agreement with that employer to say, hey, you know what, I shouldn't be here anymore. They gave me a severance package and said, here you go. That's pretty hard because Sarah and I, we had five children. I told you we have seven at the beginning. We had five children at the time, four. She was pregnant with the fifth. And here I am losing my job practically. But through God's grace, through that time, he showed me so many things. He showed me how to just be humble in certain circumstances. He showed me how to allow him to take control of what was going on in my life. He showed me in point two that I have. We can choose to have a can-do attitude. Choose to have a can-do attitude. Can-do attitude. That means I can do what is there. In Philippians 4:13, it says, I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. That's awesome. Our first child was born. Never been a parent before, right? Because it's my first kid, my first little baby. And Sarah and I, we come home. I'm like, I'll change the first diaper. I got this, right? I got this. I can take care of this. So I'm changing this diaper, and all of a sudden, this black stuff starts coming out, right? Like, it didn't look like normal stuff, right? It wasn't like poop. It was whatever that other stuff is called, okay? This black stuff, and I'm like, Sarah, something's wrong. Like, why is there black stuff in our daughter? Like, but I can do this. I'm the dad. I can take care of this. So that's what we did. We took care of it. I found out later what it was, and I said, oh, okay, so I can expect this, like, out of other children too, I guess, right? So I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. It makes me think sometimes this guy Rob Schneider, he's like, you can do it, right? Like, if he could be there and tell me, you can do it, or tell us, you can do it all the time. But we don't need that. We have scripture that tells us we can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. Okay, so we've had a few children at this point in time in our lives. We have six biological children. Our seventh one is just through different areas. He was part of the family. We've just taken him in, and he was an adoption, family adoption. And I can tell you that there's a lot of things that the enemy tries to throw at you, okay? You know, in Ephesians 6, it says, we do not fight against flesh and blood, but against the darkness and the principalities that are out there. God doesn't want us to take a step forward. Satan doesn't want us to take that step forward, okay? He doesn't want us to make a commitment. So here I am. We have six children of our own. Here's another one. I mean, we love children. Like, my wife would be foster parent right now and have four more children right now, and I'm cool with that. But back then, I was still cool with it. But at the same time, things start creeping in your head like, hey, you already got six kids. Like, another child to take care of, and this child's in diapers, and now you got to take care of formula, and you got to do these things. And hey, don't forget about the family dynamics that come with this kind of adoption that we're going through. But that's how awesome God is. Okay? I love in 2 Corinthians, I want to read this out of the Message Bible to you. Second Corinthians 12:7-10, it says, because of the extravagance of those revelations, and so I wouldn't get a big head, this is Paul speaking, I was given the gift of a handicap as a gift, to keep me in constant touch with my limitations. Satan's angels did his best to get me down. What he in fact did was push me to my knees, no danger then of walking around high and mighty. At first, I didn't think of it as a gift and begged God to remove it. 3 times I did that, and then he told me, my grace is enough. My grace is enough. It's all you need. My strength comes into its own in your weakness. Once I heard that, I was glad to let happen. I quit focusing on the handicap and began appreciating the gift. It was a case of Christ's strengths moving in on my weakness. Now I take limitations in stride, and with the good cheer, these limitations that cut me down to size, abuse me, accidents, opposition, bad breaks, I just let Christ take over. And so the weaker I get, the stronger I become.